Greetings, traders, and welcome back. Thank you for joining me again. My name is Chris, and I will be your host today during an In-Depth with Chris episode. Today, we're going to be covering the subject of aggregate supply. And considering what's going on with this whole COVID-19 situation in the global economies and very tumultuous situations, there's no better time than now to talk about this. But without further ado, let's get going. Aggregate supply. It's a scary word, yet it's the key driver of every economy. We're going to talk about the aggregate supply definition, as well as the supply curve, what shifts the aggregate supply in the long run, and even aggregate supply in the short run. And at the end of all of this, we'll even do a quick review. This is one of those subjects that is the information at the core of trading. It's not a direct trading strategy per se, but this is the type of stuff I see with the traders that have the skills to pass things like our gauntlet mini. So please pay attention. Aggregate what? Who? Aggregate supply refers to the total amount of goods and services produced in an economy over a given time frame and sold at a given price. This even includes the supply of private consumer goods, public and merit goods, capital goods, and even goods that are sold overseas. For a more simplistic definition, we can say that aggregate supply reflects the relationship between the production value of the economy and price. When prices are rising, typically it means the businesses need to expand their production and their supply to keep up with the aggregate demand. If demand rises and supply remains constant, then the consumers have to compete for all of the available goods, which in turn raises the price. By increasing the production level to sell more goods, the price then normalizes and equilibrium is finally achieved. After aggregate supply comes the aggregate supply curve. The aggregate supply curve shows a country's real GDP that is supplied at different price levels. This curve is based on the premise that as price level increases, producers can get more money for their products, which induces them to produce even more. However, this increase in price will also have a second effect, an eventual increase in input prices, which is the cost of production, which all things being equal will cause the producers to cut back on production. Keep in mind that the premise for constructing the aggregate supply curve is different from the premise used for constructing supply curves for individual goods. The supply curve for an individual good assumes that input price remains constant. As the price of a product goes up, the seller's per unit cost of providing the product don't change, and so they are willing to crank the supply even more. This is why the supply curve for individual goods typically has an upward slope. Since there is some uncertainty as to whether a country's economy can supply more real GDP amid a rising price level, it has become customary to differentiate between the two types of aggregate supply curves. The two types include the long-run aggregate supply curve and the short-run aggregate supply curve. By distinguishing the two of them, we have a more realistic overview of an economy's aggregate supply as a whole. Now let's get shifty. Anyone? No one? All right. There are many variables that can cause a shift in aggregate supply. These include technological innovations, changes in labor size and qualities, changes in production costs, availability of resources, subsidies, changes in wages and taxes, and the current inflation level. All of these factors can lead to positive or negative shifts in the aggregate supply curve. There's a shift to the right. When we have an increase in labor efficiency or a drop in the cost of production, lower inflation levels, higher output, and easier access to raw materials, things of that nature. Then on the other hand, the aggregate supply curve shifts to the left, as you can see right here, following a rise in the production costs or higher taxes and wages or reduced labor efficiency. So on the left-hand side right here, we have what happens when things become cheaper. And on the right-hand side here, we have what happens when things become more expensive to produce. First, we'll cover the long-run aggregate supply curve. The long run is a conceptual time period in which there are no fixed factors of production. Essentially, the period is expected to be long enough to allow for wages, prices, and expectation adjustments, but not long enough for physical capital to become a variable input. With that in mind, we can then define the long-run aggregate supply, known as the LRAS, as a concept that represents the optimum output that can be produced by an economy when it utilizes all of its factors of production and therefore operates at full employment. In the long run, aggregate supply is not affected by changes in the price level, and the curve only shifts based on improvements in productivity and efficiency. These improvements typically include enhanced skill levels, newer advancements in technology, and increases in capital. This essentially means that price is inelastic in the LRAS model. One important thing to note is that there are different economic views about the long-run aggregate supply. For instance, on the left, we have the Keynesian LRAS theory, which asserts that long-run aggregate supply only remains price elastic up to a certain point. After this point, supply essentially becomes uninfluenced by price changes. In other words, there is a point in the economy where producers of goods and services can expand their capacity. However, once that point is reached, it wouldn't matter whether price levels are rising or dropping. The long-run aggregate supply by nature is a completely vertical curve. You're probably wondering why, and that's just because the GDP, the real GDP, in the long run is dependent on the supply of capital, labor, and raw materials, as well as some other factors outside of price. And as a result of this, the quantity produced within that period remains the same regardless of changes in the price level, which price is inelastic. This is a stark difference from the supply curve for individual goods, which are upward sloping. In this case, it's because the curve has to do with the prices of goods in relation to other goods or services. Businesses can, therefore, take advantage of relative prices to increase output. As an example, let's say that we ran a distillery where we mass-produced bourbon and gin. If the price of bourbon rises, we can focus our resources on distilling more bourbon to take advantage of the price rise, hence the relative price influence on supply. With aggregate supply, however, the entire economy's production would be limited by the availability of land, labor, capital, and other resources. It won't matter whether the price levels increase or decrease. The overall output cannot go past the point allowed by the country's available resources. As we can see with our graphs, we can see how the LRAS curve captures the relation between price level, aggregate demand, and the production flow over a given period of time. In the classic view, even as price rises, the LRAS remains vertical. Under the Keynesian view, the LRAS curve itself is elastic up until a certain point before it becomes vertical and insensitive to price. Then we have the short-run aggregate supply curve. The short-run aggregate supply refers to the total production of goods and services available in an economy at different price levels while some production factors and resources are fixed, with fixed being the key word here. This just means that even if the companies increase their supply due to rising prices by hiring more workers or extending work hours, certain capital-intensive resources are pretty much impossible to achieve in the short run. These capital-intensive resources include things like office space, new machinery, and extra skilled manpower. There's no specific unit of time associated with a short-run period, so it may be 2 months, 8 months, or even a year. Instead of a fixed time period, it is tied to the duration for which those resources are fixed. How quickly can the company set up a new factory or warehouse? How long will it take to obtain a loan to purchase and install a new machine? Or how quickly can employees be trained to expand their skills? The answer to these questions is what determines the length of the short run. The presumption underlying the SRAS curve, which is the short-run aggregate supply curve, is that providers of resources required for production do not immediately respond to the increase in price level. For instance, in the distillery example that we were talking about, if there was a general increase in price level for whiskey and gin across the globe, the distillery may expand production right away. However, the malt and barley farmers, on the other hand, may not increase their own prices right away. It might take some time. With this chart here, we can see exactly what a SRAS curve looks like. Once again, that is the short-run aggregate supply. It shows the direct relationship between the changes in price level and the output quantity in the short run. The higher the price, the more output supplied, and vice versa. You have survived the aggregate supply. But almost. Before we go, let's make sure we remember what we have discussed. Why does the short-run aggregate supply curve slope upwards? Well, the answer is the short-run aggregate supply curve slopes upwards because it has a direct relationship with the changes in the price level in the short run. The higher the price, the higher the output. This relationship is then drawn on an upward slope. Now, question number two. Why is the long-run aggregate supply curve vertical? Well, the long-run aggregate supply, we know as the LRAS, is vertical because in the long run, changes in price do not affect the total output. Total output is instead influenced by other factors of production, such as labor, resources, and capital. Question number three, what relationship does the aggregate supply curve describe? Think about it. All right. The aggregate supply curve describes the relationship between real GDP and changes in price levels. This is broken down into two main aggregate supply curves like we covered, the short run and the long run. These are called the short run aggregate supply and long run aggregate supply curves, otherwise known as the SRAS and the LRAS. And finally, what is the effect of an increase in the price level on the short run aggregate supply curve? Think about it. Okay, an increase in price level in the short-run aggregate supply, the SRAS, means a resulting increase in the total output as companies look to profit from higher prices. This goes back to the notion that the short-run aggregate supply curve is upward sloping. The higher the price, the higher the output due to the company's desire for profit. Congratulations, everyone, and cheers. You did it. And don't worry, it's just kombucha. You figured out what the aggregate supply is in both the long-run variation as well as the short-run variation, and you made it through to the end. Now, if you think you have what it takes to take your trading knowledge to the next level, make sure you check out our Gauntlet Mini and see if you have what it takes to pass. If you do, you could become a funded trader. But other than that, thank you for joining me yet again, everybody. I appreciate it as always. Please click the like and subscribe button below so I can keep popping back out at you. Until next time, over and out. Bzzz.